Shigali, everybody, welcome back. We are on our fifth episode of our spring storytelling series. It's called A Time for Listening, Sharing, and Connecting. I've sat down with four wonderful storytellers up until this point. And our last episode will be airing at the end of April. So we are on number 5 of 6 storytellers. I'm really hoping that you're enjoying the series and that you've been able to watch the first four. If this is your first time watching, my name is Alana. I'm Vera Klein from Oneida Nation of the Thames. I'm an artist and I'm also the Parks Engagement Associate for the City of Kitchener. So as part of one of my initiatives that I'm launching this year, I'm partnering with the Kitchener Public Library to host this storytelling series. So the idea was to encourage people to sit down with us on KPL's YouTube channel and just listen to some stories from people, Indigenous people within our community. So welcome if it's your first time. If you're returning, thanks so much for supporting and for watching. I'm really excited to be going on to our fifth storyteller, and they're going to be sharing a bit of history and information on Black and Indigenous knowledge, history, culture, and readings. So really excited to be sitting down with them. Their name's Anne Marie, and they're a wonderful human. I'm going to share their bio, and then we're just going to dive right into storytelling. So Anne Marie Beals is a two-spirit Indigenous Black Ulnuwe, a mixed-blood African Nova Scotian and First Nation Mi'kmaq from the territory of Mi'kma'ki. Anne Marie is a graduate student at Wilfrid Laurier University and a story sharer working on the ProclaimingOurRoots.com project. Stories from this project revolve around Afro-Indigenous identity and relationships with Indigenous and Black communities. Their research explores the health and well-being of their communities and looking at the effects of colonial legacies of oppression and violence and lack of acknowledgement of Indigenous Black identity in the settler nation state known as Canada. Anne Marie shares Afro-Indigenous voices in uplifting the sacred stories of strength, self-assertion, and consciousness raising through the lived experiences and knowledge loudly resonating in Indigenous and Black communities. So thank you again for watching. I'm really excited to sit down with Anne Marie, and I hope that you enjoy and are looking forward to the next two. So take care.
So Quay, I am Anne Marie. I am a two-spirit Indigenous Black on the way. So I'm mixed blood African Nova Scotian and First Nation Mi'kmaq from the territory of Mi'kma'ki. Right now, I'm a graduate student at Wilfrid Laurier University, and I'm a story sharer working on the Proclaiming Our Roots project. So I am currently visiting the territories of the Attawandaron, the Anishinaabeg, and the Haudenosaunee, and I'm grateful to be welcomed to these lands, the Wallalan. So as a story sharer, I guess the stories from, especially the Proclaiming Our Roots project, they revolve around Afro-Indigenous identity and relationships with Indigenous and Black communities. So my research work explores the health and well-being of my communities and looking at the effects of colonial legacies of oppression and violence and lack of acknowledgement of Indigenous Black identity in the settler nation state known as Canada. We're basically erased from these lands. We don't hear a lot about Indigenous Black people in the media or discourse, but we're hoping that's going to change. So I share Afro-Indigenous voices in uplifting the sacred stories of strength and self-assertion and consciousness raising through the lived experiences and knowledges loudly resonating in Indigenous Black communities. So as we all know, like all Indigenous nations on Turtle Island, the Mi'kmaq have been on the land from time immemorial. We've been here forever. So on my mom's side, her father, my grandfather, is Mi'kmaq from the South Shore of Nova Scotia, but my mom was taken away as a baby and was never able to connect to her mother or her father's family in any real kind of way. On my father's side, the name Beals is a slave name. Our master's name was Beal, and as it was typical during the time of the War of 1812, enslaved Africans were forced to take their master's name with an apostrophe S. So my last name that I use now is Beal with an S, so Beals is my slave name. So for me, it's been a journey trying to understand where I come from and navigate my Indigenous Black identity. And I guess I feel pretty empowered in having a shared Afro-Indigenous identity. I mean, the fact that we are are all still here. We're here on these lands and just surviving within the dual identity traumas of so many oppressions due to colonization. I mean, that's huge. We're still here. And my ancestors have faced genocide and starvation, slavery, systemic racism, and everyday racism. White supremacy racism killed my father. And the shame inherently embedded in colonialism caused my mother so much trauma that she never thrived in life. She barely survived. And I'm not the only one. And all of those traumas are held in the blood and the bones of our people and are very much intergenerational. In the blood and bones of parents and their grandparents, all the way back to our ancestors who had first contact with the white man. So the fact that we are here and the fact that we are raising our voices is something that is empowering to me, and I just love to share those stories. And I'm a warrior. My ancestors came to me in a dream and told me that this is what I should do. Fight. The Creator shows me the way. I fight to dismantle white supremacy and colonialism and for Indigenous sovereignty so we can be back on our lands and healthy. We need to be back on our lands to be healthy. And we will take the land back from the white man. So I'm a graduate student. I was in high school, though I never finished. Guidance counselors had no problem telling me that university wasn't for people like me. And at that time, they were probably right, but not because of the white supremacist logic they were using in that Black and Indigenous people don't go to university, but should instead work to serve whiteness as domestic servants and laborers. But that for me in high school, survival was all that was on my mind. I saw the way that my mother was treated by the state, the humiliation of child welfare services inspecting every inch of our home and laying down rules to subjugate and humiliate. I felt the rawness of the pain. I saw the humiliation and I saw the depression. I witnessed my dad self-medicating to feel some release from the racism and humiliation and subjugation that he faced every day. I saw myself following in their footsteps, so I knew I had to get out. So when I finally had the opportunity to go to university, I knew that I wanted to understand why so many people in my families and my communities suffered so much death and destruction. So I do this work to honor my mother and all mothers that have to raise their children within the realms of white supremacy and colonialism, and also for the seven generations to come, in case they want to go to university. And thinking about that, you know, being in university and thinking about the way that colonial institutions operate and our children coming to these universities, what is that like for them? So I wrote a story about a student who goes to university and then heads home for summer break. So I think I'll just share that with you, if you like. So this story is called The Student and the Elder. And I have a bit of preamble for it. So we love our children. We send our children out into the world hoping that they will make it. We hope that our children will have a better life. We send our children to the white man's school so they can get an education to make it. We want them to make it. We want them to have a better life. But we know that the world is not always a welcoming place for our children outside our wombs, in the bosom of Mother Earth. But we have the rhythm of our words, the rhythm of our drums, the rhythm of our love. We must share with our children the ways of old. We must teach them the rhythms. Then when they go out into the world to make it, they have the rhythms with them in their heart. They have the rhythms in their soul to guide them when they are far from home in the white man's world. This is a story of teaching of the rhythms in a good way. This is a story to guide our children in the ways of the white man, so they can be safe, so they can be protected. The student is a youth in university. The elder is teaching the youth who believes they have made it because they are learning the ways of the white man. The youth is on their way to a better life. Yet the youth is troubled. The elder speaks of old, the rhythms of Mother Earth and the cosmos. So, the student and the elder. One day, a youth who had just come back from university for break visited an elder of the village because they were troubled and needed to seek advice. The elder sat down with the student on the riverbank and said, "What troubles you?" The student replied, "I have left my village to go to the school of the white man in the city, and I am learning the white man's ways. I am troubled because I am not farming and hunting and trapping and providing for my family, and I am failing in my task of taking care of my people." You see, the youth was learning the ways of their people before going to the white man's school, and they knew that it was part of their responsibility to take care of the people of the village, especially the elders. Yet the students saw all their life the white man. He came in all different shapes and forms. Sometimes he had a friendly shape. Sometimes he was large and bloated. Sometimes he was slithery and hidden. Sometimes he shifted his form so the student couldn't tell how the white man was coming to his people. He saw the white man coming to the village, and the student wanted to learn the white man's ways. Said the elder. "I see the white man coming to our village to help our people, yet the people do not get better," continued the student. The student pressed on. "My teachers at school tell me that it's okay because the white man knows better because he has important jobs and makes lots of money. And the teachers tell me that the white man's way is the best way. So I should learn the ways of the white man, even though he says things that sometimes I do not understand." Says the student questioned the elder. "After all, the teachers in the white man's school know what's best that should be done. And the white man knows the best way how to take care of us." And though the student was quite sure that the white man's knowledge was the best knowledge, they were not so sure that they knew the true white man, as they remembered how the white man shifts and changes. And the student thought out loud, "Though I never see the same shape of white man come back, because he must be very busy, and because he is very smart." The student lamented, "But I do want our people to get better. And if the white man's ways are the best ways, and if the white man's teachers are the best teachers, then..." "And who are your teachers?" asked the elder. "My teachers are at the university," said the student. And the elder took the hand of the student and said, "Come here." And the elder placed the ear of the student on a birch. "Listen to the tree. Do you not hear what the tree is saying?" "Whispers." And the elder took the student's head and put it on the ground. "Listen to the land. Do you not hear Mother Earth as she breathes the air?" "Whispers." And the elder took the student's hand and placed it in the river. "Listen to the river. Do you not hear the water as it rushes over the rocks?" "Whispers." And the elder took the student's arms and spread them wide. "Listen to the wind. Do you not hear the power of the Creator rush over your body?" "Whispers." And the elder took the student's face and tilted it high to the sky. "Listen to the universe. Do you not hear Grandmother Moon as she laughs with the mighty hunter?" "Whispers." And the student said emphatically, "The tree and the land and the water and the wind and the moon and the stars cannot talk. What can I learn from them?" the student asked, perplexed. "What can they teach me?" And the elder spoke their words. "There is knowledge in the white man's school, yes, but there is much knowledge to be learned from all the creations and the relations around you. There are many ways to seek knowledge and many ways to learn," the elder spoke in a whisper. "So are you saying that the white man should not come to our village to make us better?" asked the student. "Because the white man is very smart and he can fix us." "Are we broken?" asked the elder. "Well, some of our people are not happy," quipped the student. "Why are they not happy?" the student asked, sadly, quizzical. "We were happy," said the elder. My grandmother told me the stories about the times. And the elder shared the stories with the student, who listened attentively. We were growing the three sisters, fishing the eel, trapping the rabbits, and hunting the deer and moose. But now it is hard for us to do these things because we have lost our land. Now our people are sick because we do not have the land to live on. But the white man has medicine, interrupted the student. He can help us. Yes, said the elder. The white man does have medicine, but it is not the medicine we need. Our medicine comes from the land. And when the white man comes to help us, he does not ask us what kind of medicine we need. He says, it's our medicine, and it's the best medicine. Take it. And when we ask the white man to sit with us and share with us as we tell our stories, he says he is too busy and can only come to give us his medicine, which tastes awful as he forces our mouths open to accept it. And when we try to show the white man what we know and what we have learned about our medicine, he does not listen. The student continued to listen intently as the elder spoke. He does not see in his heart the good of our people, of our village. We have lived here since the time the Great Spirit made us. We have lived here since Sky Woman was guided to Great Turtle's back. We take care of the land. We take care of the water. But we do not own the land and the water and the cosmos like the white man thinks he does. The white man does not see that we are a strong people. We are the knowledge keepers of the Creator. And when the white man speaks, it is from both sides of his mouth. It is hard to trust the white man. But, stammered the student, the white man knows many big words, and my teachers talk a lot about theory. Without theory, we couldn't do science, said the student, seemingly exasperated by the elder. And what is theory? Asked the elder shrewdly, ignoring the irritation in the student's voice. Theory explains how nature works, said the student, proudly beaming, remembering the A they got on their theoretical conceptual frameworks paper. But in a lowered voice, the student revealed, but not everyone knows about it. Oh, laughed the elder. I think I can explain to you a theory then, said the elder as he continued to chuckle. We are the ancient peoples, the first peoples, and we know the ways of Mother, and we use our ways of being and knowing for our people, like our medicines and our ceremonies. This is what we do every day in our lives. It is a theory of living with the land and all our relations, cried the elder, opening their arms to show the beauty and awe of the surroundings of Mother. The elder continued in their teaching. All things matter, you know. The spirit of the Creator, all our relations, the land, the water, the four directions, all the creatures, even the rocks and mountains. They are a part of our theory and how we come to know our world. The student thought all about what they were hearing from the elder. So will the white man not come to help us anymore? Asked the student again, concerned. Is he not allowed to come help us because he talks about a different kind of theory? I think my teachers might get angry. And the student thought about how they could be punished for speaking out against the white man and the white man's teachings. The student really wanted to do well in university so that grandmother would be proud. She had sacrificed so much for them to go to university and get an education to make it, to have a better life. The elder sat and thought and thought and thought. Said the elder and puffed on their pipe. The elder finally spoke. I think the white man can come and be with us because the white man does have some good words that we can use. And sometimes the white man comes to us with good thoughts. And the white man can be gifted with an eagle feather. Exclaimed the student, an eagle feather? Wow. But, spoke the elder in a somber tone, we must always remember that the white man has tried to kill us so that we no longer exist and still tries to harm us and does not share with us what he has stolen from us, our children, our land, our knowledge. The elder resumed their teaching. We were here long before the white man, even though he tries to say that the land was empty before he arrived on these shores. So he must come to us with a humble heart and be willing to sit with us in ceremony and the sharing circle and listen to our stories and our language and not talk, though this may be difficult for him, and bring a gift of the sacred tobacco. He must be willing to come and visit with us and listen to the words that the people of our village are willing to share. And not just one time, but many times. He must earn our trust. He must believe that our knowledge is true and we use the knowledge we create together in ways that we understand. He must understand that the knowledge we create together must be shared together and used for our rights and our ability to take care of ourselves. We can show him how we do things, and he must honor our ways. He must honor our ceremony and counsel and honor our medicines that soothe and heal. He must honor our words when we speak of how our lives have come to be with the guidance and healing of the elders. He must know that we are strong and that we know to be with the land in a good way. And because we have good hearts, we can guide and heal the white man too, because he is not in a good way. But before we help the white man, he must come to understand how he thinks and be mindful of what he has done and how he continues to disturb and harm us. The white man thinks that we do not deserve to have a better life because he thinks we are lazy, or he thinks that we drink too much, or believes that we are stupid and we are different. He must speak and acknowledge that harm and be in a good mind when he comes to us. He must not consider himself to be above us, and he must understand that his knowledge is not better than our knowledge. He must give up some of his power. He must consult with the elders. He must honor all our relations. These things are part of his healing. And the elder paused and thought some more. And then continued. And the white man has laws that he is supposed to follow when he comes to us, but he does not always follow them, but he says he does. Forked tongues from a two-headed snake. And sometimes he does not tell us what he is doing, and that harms us. Sometimes he brings in outsiders who look like us, but do not know our ways of being and knowing. They say they are like us, and they are our relations, but it should be us. And if not us, then ask us if the outsiders can come in. The white man must be patient. When he takes, he must give back. And maybe the white man can come to understand that he is not just one, but a very small part of the many. We will show the white man the right ways, but he must come to us in a good way, with a good heart. And the elder sat quiet. And in the open air, as Grandmother Moon looked on, in a strong, passionate, and resolute voice, the elder heard the student say, "I could do those things. I can share my knowledge. I can sit and listen to the elders. I am learning our ways of being and knowing. I can help heal our people. I am one of us. I come with a good heart." And the elder smiled and said, "Well, you are very brave, and I think you can go back into the world of the white man and learn the white man's ways, but keep our people and our ways in your head and in your heart, because you also have a job to do in the white man's world. You must share your stories with your teachers and the white man about the importance of being respectful when coming to our village. Our elders and our people must be honored and not disrespected. Teach them as you learn the good ways. Then you can bring knowledge to us and take care of our people. But beware," said the elder earnestly. "Take care and do not let harm come to you when your teachers and the white man try to make you think that your knowledge is not good knowledge and your stories are not good stories. I will teach you the sacred knowledge, but do not share the sacred knowledge. That is ours and ours alone. And with a big grin, the elder said, "So I will do the farming and the hunting and the trapping and the fishing. We all have a place in the village, and I like farming and hunting and trapping and fishing and providing for all the families." The student grinned a big grin and was very grateful that the elder had shared with them the knowledge of the ancestors, the knowledge of old. And the elder took the student's hand once again as they walked back to the village, and their hearts were full with joy and love as father-son beamed down on them. The end. So we'll all in for that story. Okay, so as I've shared before, I am Two Spirit, and I want to share with you some stories around Two Spirit medicine. And I have this book, which I love dearly. So this is from Dr. Joseph Randolph Bowers and Elder Dr. Daniel Paul around Two Spirit medicine. So this is Mi'kmaq Bwaneg, Two Spirit Medicine. And of course, it's from the east of Turtle Island because that is where I am from. So this is called Two Spirit Narrative of Origins. So Abchilazi, welcome, come in, sit down. Welcome again to our sacred fire. Come closer, stay warm. Quay, greetings from the eastern door of Turtle Island. We wish you to imagine a long time ago when a very old elder of the people sat by the fire of her wigwam. She burned sage to purify the body and the air around about, calling in the directions, listening and staring into the fire. Your place was by the wigwam door. You waited in silence for the right time to make your offering. When it was time, the elder looked into your corner and waited to meet your eyes. You offered the ancient one gifts of sacred tobacco that you had spent a great deal of time to find and money to trade. You gave gifts of practical food and items the elder could use in daily life. You knew that their work prevented them from keeping a regular job. As healer and teacher and seer, their path was different. So you gave to them with generous heart because you asked great things of them. When the gifts were accepted, the old one said, "What do you seek?" You asked, "Please share with me the story of our origins. We wish to know the Two Spirit way." Taking up sacred turtle rattle, the most ancient of medicines, the old one of the people leaned into the fire, stoking the coals with a stick, putting more sage upon the coals. She began to chant an ancient melody. Taking sweetgrass, the elder Bwaneg leaned closer into the fire, raising that sweetgrass high into the air, burning the sacred herb of the ancestors. Your mind began to spill and sway, as if beginning to swim in the organic sounds of voice and rhythmic patterns of grandmother's turtle rattle. It was as if you heard these words echoing through the years. We honor the northeastern woodlands of the continent of North America. With our families and elders, we say Missiknikoma, all my relations. This saying conveys the secret ways of our people and our spiritual beliefs. We are all one in creation, and each one has a special place, a purpose, a calling given by Creator. We come from a tradition that honors the soul or spirit of each person, regardless what they are made of or who they come to be. In our way, we honor diversity because we see and experience this diversity in all of our creation around us. Our sacred land and water is rich with great diversity and plenty. Why would we ever discount or put aside any part of this wonderful and beautiful creation? To do so would dishonor the Creator. To do so would be to commit harm upon that which is perfect, not because we wish anything to be perfect, but because we acknowledge that the way things in creation are is giving us to teach us valuable lessons. We do not mess with creation. We respond the nature around us and within us, in our family and in our nation. We are all kin and have special relations of power, knowledge, and communication with spirits from animal, bird, plant, water, stone, and star nations. These many peoples we respect. Some are given to us personally in our family and for our nation, for special purposes. We listen to that wisdom and the teachings that come with these good relations. Within a familial and community ethic of respect and honor, we remember that the two-spirit being came about during the very first days of creation, long before the days of the old ones of the people. This is why their spirits are called ancient, the Sagui. There were the times when the stone and water nations were arguing over the boundaries of land and sea. There were the times when the mountain nations were first being formed on this great island of the sacred turtle elders. Spawned from the ancient seed of the elder turtle nation, the two-spirit Boaneg came into being. This was a time of great upheaval and uncertainty when the tides of existence were held in the balance. Huge seismic eruptions were causing enormous changes throughout the Earth world. All the six and eight sacred worlds were caught within the first drama of creation, because creation itself includes the powers of destruction, and these together are part of the sacred mystery we call transformation. Such was the drastic differences from later times. Even the forest and tree nations were not yet in existence. It was during this expansive time of tremendous conflicts and arguments between the stone nation and the water nation that the two spirit beings came together in sacred council. Knowing how much pain was being caused by petty arguments and misunderstandings, and being naturally drawn to the balance, beauty, and harmony with playful and passionate feelings, the ancient old ones, the two spirit elders, met in council and in private, as they are wanting to do when they discuss the hidden secrets of the nations. Over many days and nights of fasting and prayer by the sacred fire of the turtle elders, they together decided that enough was enough. The Beaneg spoke as one voice and said that the stone and water nations had to face their differences. Something must come from their reconciliation, after all. They had been eyeing each other off for thousands of moons without any results whatsoever. As you might guess, nothing drove the ancient two spirits more into madness and crazy mind than seeing people argue who could be making love. In an unprecedented move, the oldest among them leaned forward, raised an arm to silence the group, and stood up tall and strong. Others slowly rose to their feet and waited, until everyone was standing around the sacred fire of the council wigwam of the ancient two-spirit elders. It was then that the oldest among them shared their heart, moving that the ancient magic of the spheres was needed to save Turtle Island from disaster, which was surely to happen if this madness was not stopped and forgiveness for the past hurts between the nations was not healed once and for all time. In the moons that followed, a call went out to the land and sea from the Boaneg Council. The message was clear. It was to be set in time, a grand council of the four winds to be hosted by the eastern door of Turtle Island. This was long before the Mi'kmaq nation came to be born, but that part of the story comes later. No one except the Two-Spirit elders and the secret council knew the real purpose of this inaugural conference of nations. Even the Stone Nation and the Water Nation had no idea of what was to come. During the summer moon, the Loon Nation was called to prepare the feast, and showing their generosity of spirit and awesome hospitality, the Finned Ones offered of their own accord to give of their lives so that members of the Sacred Council would have good and excellent feed upon their long and difficult journey across the face of Mother Earth. The time drew near for the conference of the Grand Council of the Four Winds. Mother Earth herself sat at the sacred fire that would burn for seven moons before the high tide that struck the beginning of the Grand Council of the Four Winds. During these moons, the ancient Two Spirits fasted and prayed, sacrificed, and sought visions from across the sacred worlds of creation. These were the days long before the old ones of the people, and after revealing of a very special dream, the Two-Spirit elders determined that an exceptional measure was needed to host and entertain the visitors from the Four Winds. It came about one day when a vision came to one of the younger Two-Spirits. She came to her sisters and said, "I saw a really long wigwam in my dreams. It looked so strange. But inside, all the sacred visitors were seated around a huge warm fire, and the walls were decorated with sacred designs from the twigs and herbs brought in by the tree and herb nations. It smelled so lovely. At either end was an entrance, and in the other side, a passageway. So there was a flow of energy from the four winds throughout the wigwam." Those that heard the sacred dream began to weep. Their hearts were so touched that their knees went weak, as often happens with two spirits, and they nearly fell to the ground, weeping with tears of joy and happiness. In that moment, they realized in their heart that the dream was a foretelling of time of richness and plenty, when the children of the nations would be at peace and sharing their lives in harmony and balance. And this they saw was the exact fulfillment of the Two-Spirit purpose given by the Creator for all nations. Their hearts were filled with great courage and strength in their purpose. After that day, with great sanctity, there was prepared for the first ever longhouse, which was decorated with very special seven-pointed designs made from whatever gifts creation had to offer at the time. Remember, the forest had not yet grown. The land was in a big mess, so that two spirits did what they do best. And they made beautiful and lovely what was ugly and boring. They used painted stone, woven grasses, seashells beaded in wonderful sparkling designs with woven seaweed forming large wall adornments, and many other natural elements drawn together for the occasion. It was for no small purpose that this longhouse was made ready as if for a wedding feast of nations. By the time they had finished, the longhouse was fit for the finest of chiefs and dignitaries from the four winds. Even during the early days nearing the sacred council, the two spirit elders heard of enormous battles between the Stone Nation and the Water Nation. It seemed to them that they truly wished to destroy all hope for Turtle Island and to crush any chances of survival for all the nations of Mother Earth. The turmoil was so great and to such a degree that the land herself shuddered with the fierce anger of war. Mountains were appearing where there had been none. Lakes were completely drained and became barren, and rivers changed their course overnight with eruptions of fluids, gases, and ash, and changed the landscape and caused great discontent among the nations. The land kept expanding as if she wanted to dominate and control the whole surface of Mother Earth, pushing with violent rage and anger toward the Water Nation. The Water Nation, on her part, made the oceans themselves rise up with fierce anger and wash upon the land, destroying everything in sight, moving and churning again and again, as if wanting to claim the whole earth for herself, and knowing that she of all nations held the most power and would win this war in the end. But as was known and agreed by ancient law, upon the opening of the sacred sunrise ceremony of the two spirit elders in the eastern door, where Grandfather Sun first touched the easternmost point of Turtle Island, the war between the Stone and Water Nations must cease during the seven sacred days of the Grand Council of the Four Winds. During the opening ceremony, the oldest and most respected two-spirit medicine keeper raised the most ancient Turtle Nation pipe. Unlike all pipes that have come and gone, this first pipe drew together the powers of stone, air, water, and fire into one being in the body of the first turtle. The pipe bowl carried the most ancient water for healing and blessing of the body. The sacred water was taken through a beautifully carved stone stem to the lips of the two-spirit elder. Coming from the first primal medicine dreaming, the sacred grandmother's turtle pipe drew in all the old magic of earth, sea, wind, and flame. No one would dare whisper a word in the presence of the sacred elder. All were silent. In the distance outside the inner circle, Water Nation stood, watching and waiting. Closer to the circle, Stone Nation had come to listen to what was said, curious what the two spirit would say. To great surprise, without delay and with dramatic effect, the elder carried the nation pipe to the center of the circle and stood over the sacred fire, raised the head to the Sky Nation, and prayed a prayer of forgiveness. As they prayed, their body rose above the sacred fire, and those who looked on saw in the flames of time the many faces of the nations come forward. Nations that were not yet in existence, dreamed up by the elder Bwaneg. Although among these faces in blended mirage were the nations of the wolf, bear, eagle, hummingbird, otter, beaver, moose, lynx, and porcupine. Among these faces arose the white buffalo calf and the albino moose woman, who eons later dreamed again the teachings of the sacred pipe lost for so long among the ancient tides of this mysterious planet. Each person around the gathering were transfixed and listened with gaping open mouths to every word. Those who needed translation were offered by the ones with gifted tongues. During the prayer, and while the nation pipe was lifted high above the sacred fire, everyone felt nearly compelled to come closer, closer, and still closer, as the two-spirit elder whispered the most precious and delicate prayer that melted every heart and moved everyone to tears. As they were so drawn into the sacred energy of the prayer of forgiveness, their hearts melted away. When the prayer was nearly finished, those gathered there felt as if they were opening their eyes for the first time. Around the fire stood Stone Nation on the western door and Water Nation on the eastern door. No one noticed at first, but there was a subtle energy that had shifted. The great power of that two-spirit elder was manifested without anyone realizing, and only the other old two spirits knew. They quietly made eye contact with each other, as they often do, without anyone else realizing their communication. Silently, during the council, magic was happening all around the people of the four winds. Meals of wonderful fish and herbs and salads from the land appeared wherever they were needed. The two spirits signaled to each other the needs of various dignitaries and saw that their wishes were fulfilled before they even whispered their thoughts between their two ears. Such was the amazing contentment and peace of that inaugural conference that one day it was found quite without notice that two nations were standing alone by the sacred fire. Both were offering sage and tobacco to the flames of the mother, one standing in the east and the other in the west. And that's where I'll leave it there for now. But this is a wonderful book. If you ever get a chance to pick it up, so will Alan. And with that, I am done.
That was beautiful, Anne-Marie. Thank you so much for sharing. I think both of those are such strong stories, and a theme that I think a lot of people can pick up on with these winter storytelling series is that we're always coming back to community and coming back to culture. And for a lot of us, like myself, people who are mixed, people who are urban, grew up away from their culture, you know, we're taught one way and that it's a superior way. And we're not taught how to come back to, you know, our cultural ways and our ancestral ways. And that's such a hard thing to do. And, you know, adding the layer of being Two-Spirit and not having many teachings, not having many lodges led by Two-Spirit elders, that's a whole nother level of disconnect. So I think it's so powerful that you're such a strong Indigenous Black person that is reconnecting and, you know, showing people that there are these stories that we have to reclaim, that we have to relearn. And so many stories and so many people that we can reconnect with. So that was just so inspiring to hear, that of course there's trauma, of course there's such hardship, historically and currently for a lot of people, but there's also reclamation and there's also relearning. So I've known you for a few years now, and just to see you like become yourself and, you know, step into who you are and your identity now is just such a beautiful thing to witness. And I'm so grateful for what you shared. And you're such a natural storyteller and I love those stories. So thank you so much for sharing, Anne-Marie. And I'm really grateful to have you in our community and to have you holding up these stories and your research and all your work. So thank you.
Well, thank you for having me. And yeah, I mean, so many of us are just on our own journey, and it's a journey that will last us for our lives and will be shared with our children and their children in seven generations to come. So I agree with you that it really is a lot of unlearning, because there's so much that the colonial project has instilled in us, and believing that we are a certain way and that we must behave a certain way and just be a certain way. So yeah, it's taken me a long time to get where I am today. And as I say, the journey continues, but I know that there are some wonderful people out there doing some great work and looking at what it means to be mixed blood Indigenous, and also being Two-Spirit, what does that mean and how does that fit and with the teaching? So I was really quite grateful to find this book, especially coming from the eastern door of Turtle Island, so from Mi'kma'ki, from my territory. And this was shared to me by a wonderful elder and knowledge keeper, John Sillaboy, who's also from Mi'kma'ki, a Mi'kmaq elder. So yeah, so I just try to follow along and, you know, and using social media and things like that to try to connect and make those connections, because I am grateful to be on this land, but I will go back to Mi'kma'ki and, you know, continue on my journey of finding my ancestors and the people of my family and my community. So, yeah, it's an ongoing thing, and I I would be within the Indigenous Student Center at Laurier. We do this kind of work as well in going on these journeys of finding out who we are and connecting to our communities in the East. So hopefully we'll be able to continue doing that so that, you know, we can grow and learn about who we are on our journey. So, yeah.
Absolutely. Well, thank you for sharing that with us, because my intended audience, of course, is, you know, young Indigenous people who are feeling those things and maybe, you know, displaced from their like physical communities or even, you know, their cultural communities. So hearing that, you know, there's books that represent exactly who you are is really important, because we just have to search for these resources and, you know, seek out these people in our communities to help us, like help direct us and guide us. So thank you for sharing that and being such an inspiration for a lot of people and such a voice in our community. So thank you, Anne-Marie.
Well, you're very welcome.
I hope you take care, and I hope that we can keep in touch, and yeah, that you're staying safe, and enjoy the rest of your day.
Ipsilazi. Take care.
Thanks, Anne-Marie. Take care. Okay. Bye-bye.
Bye.